Happy new month. My God will give you a testimony that will beat your imagination this month. You had a testimony of others. That brother came here for the covenant of settlement, and that's the second of such testimony from that service. The other one bought a house in Abuja. This one, I said, I finished my house also in Kaduna. I bought one in Abo, in Delta State. God will give somebody a testimony that will be that one. Amen. This is our prophetic entrance service to the month of April. It's also our business breakthrough banquet service. Please, I will ask that you drop your point of contact for your business, for your career, on this ground, this same ground that brings miracles. People have come here, picked miracles. People have picked sand from here, taken to their businesses. Their businesses began to blossom. So drop that point of contact, and I see it soaking the same power, the same auction at work here, and miracles will be wrought in Jesus' name. Now, the prophetic theme for the month is, in the days of famine, I shall be satisfied. Can somebody repeat that with me? In the days of famine, I shall be satisfied. That will happen to you in Jesus' name. So in all our Sunday teachings this month, we'll be looking at gateways to supernatural blessings in hard times. Gateways to supernatural blessings in hard times. We're looking at part 1A in this first service. Please come with me to Psalm 37, 18 to 19. Psalm 37, 18 to 19 as we take our test. That brother came around here, got a one-year visa. His business that was stagnated began to blossom. Someone will have a testimony that will be that one. Amen. The testimony God will give you will make people to gather to celebrate with you. Amen. Psalm 37, 18 to 19. Please, if you are there, let's read together. One, two, go. The Lord knoweth the days of the upright, and their inheritance shall be forever. They shall not be ashamed in the evil time, and in the days of famine they shall be satisfied. Astounding scripture. The Lord knoweth, present continuous tense, up to tomorrow. He knows the days of the upright. So all God requires from us is to be upright. And it's possible to be upright and be prosperous. As Job, that became the greatest man in the East. He was a righteous man that is cured evil. And God made him the greatest man in the East. And I used to tell people, if Job should be alive today, he should be the president of OPEC. Why? Rocks were pouring out for him, rivers of oil. And I don't think it's palm oil. That's Job Oil and Gas Limited. The Lord knoweth the days of the upright. He makes me glad. So it doesn't matter what others are doing. Just be upright. God knows what is happening. It doesn't matter what is happening to you right now. God knows what is happening. Relax. He knows what is happening. And very soon you make all things to work together for your good. What they meant for evil, my God will turn it to your good. Why? He knows the days of the upright. He knows how they're oppressing you in that office. He knows how they are oppressing you in that business. But my God said he knows the days of the upright. And if he knows, he will remember you. And their inheritance shall be forever. Can't you see something here? Your inheritance is not for today and tomorrow. Now we are sure of how tomorrow will look like if we keep doing what we expected us to do. Your inheritance shall be forever, which means your generation after you shall be blessed. Somebody didn't understand this. Blessed is the man that feareth the Lord, that walketh in his commandment, that delights greatly in his commandment. He said, wealth and riches shall be his house. The generation of the upright shall be blessed. His feet shall be mighty upon the earth. Psalm 1:1-3, where we read in the opening scripture today. The generation of the upright shall be blessed. So what we are doing here, you are not only going to eat from it, your generation will eat from it. Number three thing this scripture made us to understand is that they shall not be ashamed in the evil time. So it doesn't matter the evil that comes in the land, you will not be put to shame. Your family will not be put to shame. Your business will not be collapsed. In the name of Jesus. Why am I both saying what I'm saying? The scriptures cannot be broken. God can't break it because of you. And in the days of famine, number four, they shall be satisfied. And my grandmother taught me the mystery of satisfaction. Blessed be her memory, I will never forget. She taught me the mystery of satisfaction. Anytime I see satisfaction in the scriptures, I understand it practically. You will go to her house and she will bring food and you'll be eating and eating and eating and your stomach will become signs and wonder, like a pregnant woman, shining. And she will still be asking you, do you need more? Are you satisfied? So when I see satisfaction, I know the meaning. That is you having more than enough. In the time of famine, you will have more than enough. It doesn't matter how many people are crying, you will be laughing. Because in famine and destruction, the Bible says you shall laugh. Can somebody laugh to show the devil he knows? It doesn't matter how many people are crying, you'll be laughing. I'm not the one that says so. The Almighty God says so. And it shall be fulfilled in your life. Yeah. Now hear me. Hard times are not strange to human history. We have seen hard times before. The world has experienced hard times before. But God's people will always be exempted from the hard times. In Genesis 47, we saw a story from 15 to 23, how they began to sell their cattle, their land, because money failed in Egypt. They came to Joseph, a covenant child. He said, money has failed. How do we do? Well, the only thing we have is our cattle and our land. They first of all sold their cattle, and Joseph bought. When they are selling, you will be buying. Brought their land afterwards, he bought. As a matter of fact, a time came they sold themselves. But we saw in the same Genesis 47, verse 27, that the people of God were in Goshen, having abundance in the midst of the famine. Now, hear me, in the midst of the economic holocaust ravaging the world today, you will have more than enough. Has always been and will always be, because there is nothing new under the sun. Everything you see has always been there. So hard times, part of life. The only thing is, you will not be consumed by the hard times. As a matter of fact, Jesus warned us that before the end will come, there will be a lot of tribulation, earthquakes, there be pestilences. Nations will rise against nations and all that. That will be a pointer to you that the end is drawing near. Matthew 24:6-8. But we have an escape route from all the hard times. And the covenant of seed time and harvest remains the anchor for our exemption in hard times. Genesis chapter 8:20-22. Noah reared an altar of sacrifice to God, and God smelled a sweet smelling savour, and God removed the curse that have been placed upon the earth. And God said from that time, that from henceforth, seed time and harvest shall not cease. Cold and heat will not cease. Summer and winter will not cease. In other words, God began to deal with individuals personally. So there is no group blessing. There is no group punishment. Everyone will enjoy his own reward according to his level. Seed time and harvest is the anchor for our exemption in hard times. So it is important for each and every one of us to understand this and plug himself or herself to the covenant. The covenant is our escape route from the scourge of the economic holocaust upon the earth today. What is a covenant? What is a covenant? Remember, the covenant we're talking about here is stronger than any climate. What is a covenant? Number one, a covenant means a deal enacted by God based on well-defined terms and sealed with an oath. A deal enacted by God. If you are interested, you come into it. Based on well-defined terms and sealed with an oath. Psalm 89 verse 34, God said, I will not break my covenant nor alter anything that has gone out of my lips. God is a covenant keeping God, a covenant remembering God, a covenant making God. He will never alter whatever goes out of his lips. And the covenant of God, we understand from Jeremiah 30, 20 to 21, 25 to 26, is with the covenant of day and night, and with the covenant of heaven and the earth. So any day you wake up, you see the day, you see the night, the covenant of God is at work. Any day you wake up, you see heaven in place, and you see the earth in place, the covenant of God is at work. And the covenant is behind the power to make words. Deuteronomy 8:18. And you shall remember the Lord your God, for it is he that giveth the power to make words. So the power to make words is given. That is why somebody can be a professor of economics and still lack. And another can be a farmer and still be feeding many. It is God that giveth us the power to make words. Why? To establish the covenant which he made with our fathers, even as it is this day. So any day you wake up and you see it is called this day, the covenant is at work. And when the covenant is at work, no witch, no wizard, no power can stop you from getting ready. If you understand this, you will hide yourself in the covenant. This is what God's servant, my master Bishop Oyedepo, discovered that made him to shout, I can never be poor. Now hear this. It is important that we recognize that every seed we sow is not a donation to help God. Understand that the seed is the most powerful force on the earth. And any seed you sow is not a donation to help God. It's not a donation to help a ministry. It's not a donation to help a man of God or a minister of God. No. It is a spiritual transaction. Something has gone into your future to wait for you. No seed sown remains the same if the ground is correct. It will always return back a multiplied fold. Hear me. Don't ever sow any seed at any time thinking you want to help God or you want to help the church. Some people, that's the kind of seed they sow. They look at somebody saying, look, he's looking hungry, let me sow. That is not it. If you are doing that, you don't understand. You don't understand. It is not to help God. It is not to help the church. It is not to help the minister. It is a spiritual transaction. It's a spiritual transaction. Our seed sown is a spiritual transaction that provokes divine favor. It provokes divine favor in our lives. When Noah's reared that total sacrifice, the curse on the earth was lifted for his sake. The curse was lifted. Here, men may receive it, but in heaven, Jesus receives every seed you sow. He receives it. And the less is blessed by the better. You cannot But be blessed as you sow into the kingdom. That is why this month, by the grace of God, we'll be looking at these gateways to supernatural blessings in hard times. And I see God of heaven exempting you in the name of Jesus Christ. Exempting you in the name of Jesus Christ. Now hear me. I want to tell you something here now. If things are hard for you, it doesn't mean that it's hard for everybody. Are you following me now? That's why anywhere you go, if you see people building house, tell yourself that there's money here. Is it okay? In the same church where you are, this is the second testimony we're hearing this morning from the covenant of settlement we heard this year. Somebody after that, between Wednesday, between Monday, between Sunday and Wednesday, he was paid some money. He bought a house in multi-millions in Abuja. This is another one today. He was paid money also within the same period. And he has finished his house here. He has finished, he bought a house in multi-millions in Delta State. That things are not going well for you doesn't mean it is wrong for everybody. So understand and find out what it takes for it to work for you. And if you find out and you plug yourself to it, it will also work for you. Now hear me. In famine and in destruction, you shall laugh. In famine, you shall be satisfied. In the name of Jesus. By the covenants, we are exempted from what others suffer. That is why we are saying your case is different. What others suffer is not, you are not permitted to suffer it. What affects others is not permitted to affect you. By the covenant, if this can only happen when you are in the covenant. If you are not in the covenant, what affects others will affect you. Understand this. So if you are saying it, my case is different. I'm a covenant child. What affects others will not affect me. Hey, note that you must be in the covenant. I'm a covenant child. That's it. That is what qualifies you to be exempted from what affects others. Exodus chapter 8, verse 20 to 24. We saw something here proving that the covenant exempts us. Exodus 8, 20 to 24. As God's people were in Egypt, Pharaoh refused them to go. God told Moses, go to Pharaoh, tell him, let my people go. And if my people will not go, I will bring another plague. And this time, what was the plague? Swarms of flies. He said, I will make swarms of flies to come around the whole Egypt and all the Egyptians and their houses everywhere. But look at verse 23. God said, I will put a division between my people and thy people. Tomorrow, you shall see this sign. Now hear me. Somebody is here today. Between now and tomorrow, God will give you a sign. Some of you get home today, you will see the sign. Some of you, as you live here now, you open your phone, you will see the sign. They will call you, they will send for you. It is for your employment, it is for your blessing, it is for your favor, it is for your change of story. I will put a division between you. So God is still in the business of putting division between people. I'll put a division between you and my people. Who are his people? The covenant children. Gather my saints unto me, who have made a covenant with me by sacrifice, and the heaven will declare his righteousness. Psalm 50, 5 and 6. So there are people God called his people, the covenant people. And when you enter into the covenant with God, doing what you're supposed to do, you line up for divine exemption from the famine on the earth. That's why I told you here that the covenant of seed time and harvest is the key to supernatural blessing in hard times. Some people may think, oh, these hard times, is it not time for us to reduce our sowing? That is the wrong and the worst thing to do. No, it is time to sow the hardest. Glory to God. It is the time to do it more covenantly because it's creating a future for you. So the covenants of seed time and harvest is the supernatural, is the key to supernatural blessing in hard times. We saw The widow, the Shunammite woman, in 1 Kings 17, 18 to 20, she arranged with the husband to make Elijah comfortable. And to make Elijah comfortable. Now, and by it, she never suffered anything. She never. Hear me. When the brook dried, and Elijah had to move from the brook Cherith and entered her house, where she only had what to eat and eat and die with her son, Elijah said, "Give it to me first." And when she did, in the time of famine, 3.5 years, she had abundance. People were coming to eat in her house. Now, that was a little seed that she could have cooked with two sticks and ate with the son and died. But this woman said, "No, according to the instruction of Elijah, bring it to me first." And she gave to the man of God first. And because of that, she ate all the days of her life in abundance. Now, when it is not enough, sow it as a seed. When it is not enough, don't forget this. When it is not enough, if it is not enough, sow it as a seed. Many eat their seed to their detriment. There is bread to eat, there is seed to sow. When you eat all the seed, you have nothing left for the future. May God give us understanding. Quickly, before we conclude in this service, let's look at terms of the covenant or supernatural blessing. Terms of the covenant. What are the things? Because every covenant must have terms. If you do your own side, because God is a covenant keeping God, there is no God is a constant factor in the quadratic equation of life. There is no variableness in him, neither shadow of turning in him. So if you do your own side, if you keep your own terms, God will always keep his own. So what are the terms available to us if we must enjoy supernatural blessing even in hard times? Number one is the Titan covenant. Titan. Let me tell your neighbor, Titan. Okay. Some people want to close their eyes now. Some people don't like this one. Anytime you talk up to this one, they say, "Touch not my pocket. I do my money no harm." Hear me, but you can't escape it. None of us can escape it. No business can escape it. No church can escape it. This church you see, we pay tithe as a church. The same way your business must pay tithe. If you're a businessman here, businesswoman here, you must pay tithe for your business. You must pay your own, the one you get by yourself. So you collect tithe booklet for your business, you collect for yourself. Very important. If you don't want Deborah to visit the business. Now, hear me. Some people have argued and said, "Look, this tithing thing is too much now. Are we not under grace?" We are not under the law. Tithe precedes the law. Abraham paid tithe 500 years before the law. Jacob paid tithe 250 years before the law. The law came by Moses. These men have already discovered it since, and they were practicing it. Genesis 14, 19 to 20, remember. After Abraham returned from recapturing Lot and all their goods, he came to Melchizedek, the priest of God, and gave him tithe of all. Say with me, tithe of all. Say with me, tithe of all. Some people will pay tithe of some. He said, "This one is salary, I pay. This one is dash, I no go pay." You know, God is wiser than all of us. That's why the Bible said, "Bring you all the tithes into my storehouse." All, not some. All the tithes, all into my storehouse. All. Because he knows somebody will give you, show you favor here. They will send you for an assignment and then pay you some bonus. To all, a tithe is simply 10% of your earning, 10% of your income. You don't pay tithes from, for instance, school fees. Your husband give you money for housekeeping, you don't pay tithe from it. If he gives you money to spend your own, you can pay tithe from it. From your profits, you're a businessman, you do a business, you pay from your profit. Now hear me, many people are not paying some of them that are paying, but they're not paying correctly because they don't keep records. So if you're a businessman here, the first thing to do, a businesswoman, is to keep records of your dealings. If you can't keep records, you will not be able to pay tithe correctly. If you don't understand as far as I've said now, come to the Bible schools tomorrow. But that's the problem many people have. They don't keep records. For a civil servant, yes, you know you can get that, and it is paid from your gross, not from your net. After you have collected a loan and they're deducting the loan, you say, yeah, Pastor, don't be this one, enter my hand. You're wiser than God. He knows what your salary is. Glory to God. All these things are, by the way, just to help us understand better. But hear me. Abraham that paid tithe, even in famine. Remember, there was famine also in the time of Abraham. But Abraham ended up well blessed. God blessed him in all things. Genesis 24 verse 1. God had blessed him in all things. Now, if you are not paying tithe here, you are simply eating the forbidden fruit. Help me tell your neighbor, forbidden fruit. Yeah. Some of us, every time you get angry, you say it's Adam that caused this problem for us. If Adam and Eve didn't eat that forbidden fruit, we won't be suffering now. But you are eating it today. What Adam and Eve ate was the tithe. God said, all the trees in this garden, you can freely eat. But this one, keep it for me. Don't eat from the tree of life. They say, no, devil deceived them. He said, this is the one to eat from. That's the same thing. God gave you 100% and said, look, give me 10%, take 90%. But he said, God, this one... If 100% is not even enough, how would 90% be enough? But try it. Ask people who have been doing this. You discover that if you eat it, it will never be enough. But if you do it, you discover that that one you have, it will be enough for you. Practice it. May God give us understanding. Let me ask your neighbor, do you pay tithe? What is the answer? If you are not paying, you repent. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Because if you want to escape the hard time, this is the way to it. Number two is the worship offering. And what is the offering? This is the offering we bring to God anytime we appear before Him. Now hear me, all these things are important. What the tithe does is that the tithe opens the heavens for you. It's like you farming and the rain coming down. If there's no rain, anything you put on the ground will not work. If you are giving offering and you are not paying tithe, there is no rain coming on your seed, the seed will dry up. If you are paying tithe, you are not giving offering, there is nothing you are planting after the heaven is open for it to germinate for you. So you have to do all of them. God is a God of details. So you do each one. The one you are not doing is what is undoing you. Say with me, I hear. So after giving your tithe, worship offering. Anytime you appear before God, Deuteronomy 16:16, the Bible says you should not appear before God empty. So anytime you're appearing before God, don't come empty-handed. I plead with you in the name of Jesus. Don't try it. Many are doing it today. When it's time for offering, they escape. I just look at that. Many, when it's time for offering, they think they're deceiving pastor, deceiving their neighbor. They carry plain envelope and fold it so that it will look like something is inside and drop it inside. You say, God, you understand. God says, I understand. Aluta. Some even squeeze your hand like this as if something, you will now drop it down. You know the one you are doing. You understand? Please, in the name of Jesus, don't ever appear before God empty. Now, the truth is this, if it is in your heart, God will put it in your hand. If it is in your heart, if you really desire that I want to do this, Within the course of the week, how many services? Wednesday and Sunday. God will put what it takes. As a matter of fact, it's a question of planning. When you receive your salary, determine your... I do covenant. I can't tell you again because I know it brings envy. I can't tell you the kind of offering I'm giving today. I can't tell you. I can't. But when I came to this church, I started with 5 naira. And I've seen God lift me. And he's still lifting me. What we gave yesterday is what we are eating today. What we are going to eat tomorrow is what we are giving today. Get to understand. If you understand this, nobody will encourage you. Never appear before God empty. I've given this word before. I put my shoe before to give. I put tithes before to give. To ensure that I don't come empty. I've gone to sell bonds so that I can have offering to give. It's a question of understanding. But have a covenant something. There's amount I give every day. Every service. These 3 services today, I must give that amount. Whether I eat or I didn't eat. And God has been faithful all the years. It's a question of understanding. So don't get angry with some people when they're being blessed. Find out what they're doing. The next one is giving to your parents. Giving to your parents. Ephesians 6, 1 to 2. Honor your parents in the Lord. Obey your father and your mother that they may be well with you. That you may live long on the earth. That you may live long on the earth. This is the only commandment with a promise. That he may be well with you. To be well with you means all-round prosperity. And that you may live long on the earth. How do you honor people? Honor the Lord with your substance. Some of you here, you need to go back today, this week. You've not been doing it static. Go and send something to your father and your mother. Somebody say, my father and my mother, they are witches. Bring it, I will pray for you, I will anoint it, give them. You are not doing that because of them, because you are doing that obeying the word of God. That he may be well with you. Some are even quarreling their parents. How will he be well with you? Please, before your parents die, if they're not dead already, what do you do? Collect any blessing you can collect from them. Let them pray for you as you do that. Let them bless you. Now, there are 2 kinds of parents here. We have the spiritual parents and you have your natural parents. And they have their own place. There is the blessing of the spiritual father. There is the blessing of the natural father. They all count before God. But that of a spiritual father is stronger. Because Moses reversed the course a natural father put upon Reuben. Genesis 49, 2 and 3. Jacob cursed Reuben. You are the excellency of my power, but because you are stable like water, you will not excel. That's not blessing, that's a curse. But in Deuteronomy 3, verse 6, Moses came and said, let Reuben live and not die. The blessing of a spiritual father is stronger than the curse of a natural father. Understand? And you need to service both sides. You need to service both sides. Both your natural parents, your biological parents, and your spiritual parents. Who is your spiritual father? Who is your natural father? Even if they are dead, look for somebody to stand in that gap and be offering that blessing for you. Very, very important. When Jacob brought the venison to, Isaac, he got the blessing. It is the one that brings the venison that takes the blessing. Never forget this truth. However, before we close, please, sow these seeds willingly, sow it joyfully, and how will God bless you as you do this? God blesses us by giving us divine ideas. He blesses us by giving us divine ideas. As you sow, God will give you divine ideas. God will never rain money from heaven, but he will give you an idea that will produce money for you. Number 2, God can bless you through priestly blessing. Priestly blessing. Number 6, 23 to 27, God told Moses to tell Aaron how to bless the people. He said, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord be gracious to you and let his face shine upon you. Let him lift the light of his countenance upon you and bless you. And then he said, you put my name upon their forehead and I will bless them. So you can enjoy priestly blessing. Priestly blessing. Priestly blessing. Some of you are traveling here. You're going for an interview. You come around. They just say a word to you. And you see it confirmed. You're going for a competition, for contract. You say a word. It happens. But some think that they are better. They know better. They've been going to their own frustration. It is only what you need. God blesses us true priestly blessing. You will never remain the same. In Jesus' glorious name. So today I bless you with the blessing of a father. I bless you with the blessing of a priest. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord cause his countenance to shine upon you. May the Lord enlarge your course. May the Lord be gracious to you. May his face shine on you. And may the Lord give you your desires. In the name of Jesus Christ. Please rise on your feet. Now, before we pray here, I'm close today. I want to give opportunity to everyone here who is not born again. Now, you cannot get an inheritance in a family where you are not a member of that family. You cannot get an inheritance that is for the saints in light, except you are born again, child of God. You make Jesus your Lord and your Savior. So as our eyes are closed, our heads are bowed, you are here, you want to give your life to Jesus, put your hand on your chest right now, pray this prayer of salvation with me. You gave your life yesterday or sometime, but you know you are no more there. You don't have peace, you don't have joy. You can return back to Jesus right now. Please rededicate your life to him. You want to do that, put your hand on your chest also, pray this prayer of salvation with me. You're also struggling with certain habits. We had a testimony today, deliver from chronic masturbation. Now, some are struggling with certain habits that only Jesus can break. You can be like that brother. God deliver you. I don't know what you are struggling with, but you can return to Jesus right now. Put your hand on your chest. Pray this prayer of salvation with me. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. I believe in my heart you are the only Son of God. You died and you resurrected on his third day. Today, from my heart and with my mouth, I confess you as my Lord and my Savior. Jesus, write my name now in the book of life. Thank you for saving me. I'm born again. I'm yours. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. I want everyone to pray. Father, empower me to engage myself in the covenant. And as I do, cause me to escape the financial holocaust ravaging the world. In the name of Jesus, make me to be satisfied even in famine. Go ahead, pray that prayer in Jesus' name. Father, I ask for empowerment and grace to walk in the covenant. As I do, Lord, cause me to flourish, cause me to enjoy satisfaction even in the midst of the famine, cause me to escape the financial holocaust ravaging the world today. Thank you, mighty God. In Jesus' glorious name. Now pick your point of contact right now. I don't know what you are doing for a living. My own, I'm in the business of the world. Parole de Dieu. Now lift that point of contact. Father, in the name of Jesus, we declare every point of contact here blessed. The works of your hand blessed. Your business blessed. Your career blessed. Today I perform the priestly blessing upon you. Your mouth will never see your back again. I command doors, unimaginable doors, to open to your business, to open to your career. You will not see a better yesterday again. Therefore, everyone desiring a visa, I command your visa release. Those desiring contract, I command your contract to become. Those desiring payment for jobs and contracts, don't receive your payment now. Everyone desiring success in the academies, in the work of your hand, success will answer to you. You shall no longer be stagnated. You shall go forward in the name of Jesus. In this month and beyond, the testimony you have never shared before will come your way. The same way God, through Jesus, blessed Peter and he had a net-breaking harvest after toiling. I don't know how you have toiled in the first quarter. This second quarter and beyond shall be seasons of testimony for you. No more toiling in the name of Jesus. No more laboring in vain in the name of Jesus. You shall not bring forth for trouble in the name of Jesus. Oh, I don't know why this one is coming. The herald that has been seeking your life is dead. The herald that has been seeking your life is dead. before the sun is hot tomorrow, help will come your way. My God will help you, and you shall not be put to shame. For your shame, you shall receive double. Go in this your mind. Go and flourish. Go and be blessed. Now, some of you, you'll be rejecting clients from now. You'll be rejecting customers from now. Why? There'll be too much for you to handle. There'll be too much for you to handle. My God will launch you to the realm of more than enough. In Jesus' glorious name. Remember, in famine, you shall be satisfied.